Good morning, Cornerstone. Stand to your feet, put those hands together. Let's give praise to Jesus this morning.
Lift your head, weary sinner. The river's just ahead. Down the path of forgiveness, salvation's waiting there. You build a mighty fortress, 10,000 burdens high. Love is here to lift you up, here to lift you high. If you're lost, wandering, come stumbling in like a prodigal child to the world.
Everybody doing? Who is totally 120% excited about being in church this morning? Amen. Well, we're so glad you're here with us today. Whether you're worshiping in here, in the gathering online, we're glad that you're here. So today, I need everybody, take out your cell phone. If you get a chance, check into Facebook. Why do we do Facebook? Well, we do it for a couple reasons. One, to let all your friends know that you're at church this morning. Amen. That's a good way to preach the word. The second way is for so many check-ins, we end up giving money to a charity that does some outstanding things, and that's a really good thing. So let me ask you a question. Why do we worship? My challenge for you today, I know next week is Easter, and we need to get ready for Easter, but let's set the foundation for next week. Let's worship like we've never worshiped before. Let's go deeper than we've ever gone before. Why? Because the presence of the Lord is here. Amen. Are you excited about God being here? I am too. Let's get our worship on. Amen.
Nothing can separate, even if I run away. Your love never fails. No, I still make mercies for me every day. Your love never
Everybody get those fingers snapping, all right? Just like this. Come on. Can you do that? Come on. If we all do it together, it'll make some sound in this place. Come on, everybody. Thank you for Jesus this morning.
My home. Church, Father, Jesus, we just thank you for your name. God, the name that is above every name. Lord, we thank you that your word says that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that you are Lord. And that's what we just do right now, Father God. We take that moment to just confess that you, Jesus, you are Lord of our life. We surrender everything to you, God. We turn our hearts, we turn our lives, we turn our emotions, our focus completely on you right now. And we just invite you to change us. God, and we just give you all the praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Thanks so much for worshiping with us.
When you're scared to invite someone to church this Easter, you procrastinate. When you procrastinate, you worry that it might be too late. When you worry that it might be too late, you resort to desperate measures. When you resort to desperate measures, you end up on the 6 o'clock news and become ostracized by your entire community. When you become ostracized by your entire community, you're forced to relocate to Possum Neck, Mississippi, and change your name to Skeeter. Don't relocate to Possum Neck, Mississippi, and change your name to Skeeter. Invite someone to church this Easter.
Well, I've never been to Possum Neck, but I have been to Toadsuck, Arkansas. Anybody ever been, honestly, anybody ever been to Toadsuck, Arkansas? There's a few. It's a real place. It's a real deal, so... Anyway, good morning, guys. Good to see you this morning. Glad that you're here. You caught us right in the middle of a remodel, and so this is just a framework for our new outlook, our new look on the stage for Easter Sunday, which is next week, of course. And so our IT team and techs guys, I mean, they've been working really hard. It's going to be an amazing looking set. So Thanks for being patient with us. It's been kind of nice just to do the acoustic set and scale down a little bit. But glad you're here this morning. We're going to wrap up the series from the book of Ephesians, Sit, Walk, Stand, that we actually started quite some time ago. And we made pretty good progress until we hit the sixth chapter of the book of Ephesians. And we really began to deal with and delve into spiritual warfare. And then when we got to the armor of God, we just began to break down every piece of the armor because it is so vital for victory in the life of the believer that we understand what this armor is, how it operates, and how we benefit from it. And so today we're going to wrap up with the helmet of salvation and share with you some things about breaking strongholds in our lives. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 17, let me just share this verse of scripture with you. It says, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. I want to begin this morning by focusing in on two words here, and they are the word salvation and the word helmet. Just to make sure that we really have a clear understanding of what we're talking about. First of all, the word salvation. The word salvation comes from the Greek word sozo, and it means a whole lot more than just fire insurance. In other words, sozo is an all-inclusive term meaning not only eternity in heaven, but also heaven on earth. Sozo means healing. It means prosperity. It means fullness and newness of life. This life that Jesus mentioned in John chapter 10, this abundant life. And so there's a whole lot to it, and we begin to understand this word. Salvation isn't just one thing, it's many things. In fact, Psalms 103 verse 2 says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of his benefits. Now, I know that when we serve Christ, there are ups and downs and there are highs and lows. But I also know this, there are far more highs than there are lows. There are more benefits to serving God than there are drawbacks. And so God said, don't forget all of my benefits, which is part of this salvation package. And then look at the word helmet. I mean, obviously, a helmet is designed to protect your head. But since we're talking about spiritual armor, we could say the helmet of salvation is designed to protect the mind, the way that we think. Most people lose the benefits of salvation or lose their covenant blessings because of the way they think, because of wrong thinking or defeated thinking. And see, if the helmet of salvation is not protecting your mind, then you'll lose the benefits and the blessings of being a Christian. In fact, if you don't wear the helmet of salvation, by the time the enemy is through with you, all you will have left is heaven. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm a huge fan of heaven, looking forward to going there. But I'm just saying, God wants us to have heaven to go to heaven in. God wants us to live in victory. God wants us to have joy. God wants us to succeed in this life even before we go to heaven. And so if you don't wear the helmet of salvation, listen, you're not going to have any defense against depression. Did you know that depression is their number one health problem in America today? And I'm not just talking about clinical depression. I understand that's different, that's separate, but day-to-day depression, people suffer from depression, and it is an epidemic. It's a depression that comes as a result of a spiritual attack on your life. I shared last service that there are three areas that when we face an attack of the enemy, there are three areas that Satan attacks. One is our mind, which is what we're talking about today. Number two is our mouth, our words, because we know according to Proverbs, the power of life and death are in our words. And the book of James says that our tongues are set on fire of hell. And the third area that he attacks is our physical body, or attacks us in the physical realm. But we're focusing primarily today on our thoughts and the helmet of salvation. And if you don't have on this helmet of salvation, then you have no defense, not only against depression, but against fear. See, the Bible calls fear a spirit that is sent from Satan to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Fear is a spirit that is sent to rob you of God's best. How many of you realize that you cannot live in fear and faith at the same time? They do not coexist in your life. And you either need to be in one or in the other. If you're not in faith, you're going to be living in fear. And if you're living in fear, you're not in faith. And then when you add to that, that the helmet of salvation reminds me that Satan is defeated. I mean, no, that's a good thing, right? See, what happens then, if I don't have the helmet of salvation, then fear is a very difficult subject to deal with. There are a lot of people that fear a lot of things in their life, but I think most people fear the past of what they have done, what they should have done, or what's in the past. But when I put on the helmet of salvation, the helmet of salvation reminds me that my past is forgiven. Say a good amen. Come on, that's freedom for a lot of people that are still struggling with their past. The helmet of salvation reminds me my past is forgiven. When I face sickness and disease, the helmet of salvation reminds me that by his stripes I am healed. When I face poverty or financial setback, the helmet of salvation reminds me that I've been redeemed from the curse of the law. And so all the benefits that God has for me are obtained through this thing called salvation. And then if I could just throw one more thing in there, that if I don't have the helmet of salvation, then I don't have any defense against anger, bitterness, brokenness that so many people struggle with in life. But salvation, what God's word says about me, lifts me up above the fray. Let me give you the definition, a definition of helmet of salvation. The helmet of salvation is the mind of Christ. In fact, say that with me. The helmet of salvation is the mind of Christ. One more time to make sure we're tracking. The helmet of salvation is the mind of Christ. So what is the mind of Christ? The mind of Christ is when we begin to think the way Jesus thought. When we begin to have the attitude that Jesus had towards life. Not only towards life, but the mind of Christ is when I have the same attitude that Jesus had towards God. Jesus' attitude towards God was that, God, whatever your will is for my life is what I want. That's a healthy attitude. Jesus said, I just want to obey God completely and immediately. God, whatever you want in my life, whatever your will is for my life is what I want. That's the helmet of salvation. That's what the mind of Christ is, that I don't fight against God, but I'm quick to obey God. The mind of Christ is when I look at the enemy, Satan, and I remind myself that he is a defeated enemy. That I remind myself spiritually he's been placed under my feet. The mind of Christ is when I look at mankind, I look at people around me, and I realize I'm not fighting against people. They're not my problem. But there is a motivation behind these people that cause them to do what they do and say what they say. I'm just going to keep loving people and fighting the devil. Amen. I know this is kind of one of those old school messages, but we need it from time to time. So the mind of Christ is when I begin to have the same attitude that Jesus had towards God, towards Satan, towards man, towards life, towards eternity, towards whatever. I think what Jesus thought. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. If you don't have this verse highlighted in your Bible, I encourage you to highlight it or mark it in your e-Bible, and it says this, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Now, what did we just read here? I mean, what does that say really? The word imaginations means this. It means logic or logical thinking. And what the Bible is saying is that sometimes our logical thinking, our way of reasoning contradicts the word of God. We can reason ourselves right out of the blessings of God. Because God made this statement and he said that his thoughts are not our thoughts. That his way of doing things are above our way of doing things. And sometimes we have this bad habit of trying to dumb God down. In other words, we got to drag God off the throne down to our level and make him fit in our little religious way of thinking. And the Bible says that's logic, or our own logic oftentimes robs us of the blessing of God because it contradicts the word of God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, there's a great story that really paints a picture of this. There was this very important man, a Syrian, I believe. His name was Naaman. And Naaman's thing was he was a leper. He was a very important general, a very important man. He's one of the king's right-hand men. But he had this thing called leprosy that is incurable. But he heard about a prophet in the land that could heal, that could do miracles, Elisha. So he gets permission from the king to go visit Elisha, this powerful, miracle-working man of God. He takes all of his entourage and he shows up where Elisha was staying at, and he says, I'm a very important man. I need to talk to Elisha. But Elisha won't even come out and see him. Elisha sends his assistant out, Gehazi. And Gehazi comes out and says, you know, here's what my master says to do. He says, all you need to do is go jump in the lake. Not once, but seven times. Go dip in the Jordan River seven times and just see what that does for you. Naaman went crazy. He got offended, he got mad, he got angry, he was going to ride off. And one of his servants said, what if Elisha had asked you to go to defeat some big army? If he gave you something hard to do, would you do it? He said, why don't you trust him in the little thing? And here's what Naaman said. They know the end of the story. Naaman eventually did it and was healed of leprosy. So this is the middle of the story, the conflict. And Naaman was offended, and here's why he was offended, because he said, I thought the man of God would come out and make a big deal about me and say some magic words and do some real big ceremony. And that phrase, I thought, those words, I thought, have probably robbed more believers of the blessing of God than any other phrase. Because I thought God would do this, or I thought God should do that, or I thought God would move this way. Most of the time, when God moves in our life, it's usually not the way we have it all planned out for him to. And our way of thinking oftentimes contradicts the word of God, and it limits God from working in our life. See, if Satan can get you to reason God's word rather than believe God's word, he'll defeat you every time. And if you don't take your thoughts captive, what ends up happening is that your thoughts will take you captive. So God saves you and gives you a new beginning. See, when God saves you, he solves the biggest problem you ever had in life, which was sin. But even after you get saved, there are still some problems that you need to work your way through. God saves you, but you have to renew your mind. How many of you here have ever heard the phrase sacred cow? Anybody know? Heard that? You know what that is? The phrase sacred cow in the church world means it's a belief or a tradition that I'm not willing to give up. Even though it may be wrong, it's something I believe in and I'm not willing to change. It comes from because in India they have these things that are called sacred cows, these cows that they believe are sacred or are gods. And they won't eat these cows, even though they may be starving to death. They believe that these cows are gods and they won't eat them. In fact, they will take even what little food they have and feed them to this so-called god. So it is a sacred cow that we step back and look at and think, that's crazy. You're keeping yourself in bondage. But we have them in church and have them in our lives all the time. These things, these attitudes, these thought patterns, these way of doing things that we just say, that's the way we're going to do it, and I'm not willing to change. It is a religious way of thinking. Mark 7 and verse 9, Jesus said this. He said full well to a group of religious people. He said full well, you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your own tradition. Can I just list for you a few sacred cows? Here's a sacred cow. We just talked about it. Well, I think or I feel or I believe. I know what God says. I know what the Bible says. But let me tell you what I believe. What's wrong with this picture? That's a sacred cow in a lot of people's lives. Here's another one. Well, it's been my experience. that we are more experiential than we are believing what God says. I'm going to base it upon my experiences and what I know. Who cares what God's word says? I've experienced some things. Here's one. Mama said, or I was taught. I've always been taught. It's a sacred cow because we're not willing to break that to hear the truth. Or my church or my denomination. You know that sometimes denominations become sacred cows? Churches become sacred cows. So we got to come to that place that we just look at God's word and accept God's word. In Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, here's some great advice. I love this verse. One of my favorite verses, one of the most powerful verses, I think, in the book of Romans. And says, do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The word conformed means don't fit the mold. Don't let the world mold you into its way of thinking and its way of doing things. We are in the world, but we're not of the world. So therefore, we don't act or react like the world. We're marching to the beat of a different drummer. We're going a different direction. So we're not transformed by the world, but we're not conformed by the world, but we're transformed by the renewing of our mind, causing our mind to line. Listen, there's two ways that you can think, go through life. You can think carnally, that means to think like the world, think in your own limited knowledge, or you can think spiritually. You can be carnally minded, which the Bible says is death, or you can be spiritually minded, which the Bible says is life. I like to say it this way. You can be led by the spirit man, that part of you that is most God-like, that part of you that God speaks to, that part of you that is hardwired from heaven to hear God's voice, the real you. You can live life according to the spirit man or according to the weather man. That means every day when you get up, you just kind of read the forecast and say, well, whatever the circumstances say, that's what my day is. I just look out the window and say it's going to be a rainy day, a bad day. I just look at the weather and say, well, that's how it is. Faith doesn't do that. Faith calls those things which be not as though they were. So you can live according to your circumstances, according to what's out there, or you can live by faith and live according to your spirit man. The spirit mind, the spiritual mind, always lines up with the word of God. Not 50-50, not 70-30, not even 80-20, but always lines up with the word of God and says, I choose to believe what the Bible says, what God's word says. So sometimes, and has anybody ever done this other than me? Have you ever read a verse in the Bible or heard a message and just realized God is giving me a major attitude adjustment right now? Anybody ever done that, right? There's a guy in the Old Testament by the name of Jonah that God gave him a major attitude adjustment. God allowed him to spend 3 nights in a whale motel. And at the end of those 3 nights, Jonah got his life together. He got his mind right, and God said, now I can put you back on track. Do you see how important our thinking is? It will derail us. It will sidetrack us. It'll put us in the wrong direction. So renewing the mind, according to that scripture that we read, is a two-step process. One, we got to cast down imaginations or refuse to think certain ways. And number two, we got to think on these things. One, we got to not think this way, but think this way. Philippians 4:8, whatsoever things are true, honest, just, pure, lovely, of good report, think on these things. Matthew 22:37. I love this verse. In fact, I've been sharing this verse with just different people this week. And here's what Jesus said. He says, you shall love God with all your strength, with all your soul, and with all your mind. For this is the first great commandment. Now, when I love God with all my strength and all my soul and all my mind, I can sum that up in one word and say passion. Everything I've got goes to God. Do you realize that being passion-filled is a commandment from God? It's not a suggestion. It's not a word of encouragement. It's not something that we can look at and ignore. But Jesus says that every believer ought to be passion-filled towards God. That's a commandment. So that means being lukewarm is not an option. That means being a Christian that sits on the fence or lives in the gray areas is not an option. We are called to be passion-filled people. And if you don't, if you're not passionate, and you don't stay passionate for God, you open the door for the devil to come in and control your life. Think of it this way. Your lack of zeal or passion will eventually turn you lukewarm. So I really believe that one of the greatest hindrances to victory in people's life is a lack of passion. Being half-hearted instead of wholehearted. There are a lot of believers that live their life on autopilot spiritually, just kind of going through the motions. But God wants us to be focused. God wants us to be intense. Let me give you an example. You ever seen these movies where there's a bomb that's about to go off and it's got the timer and it's the digital timer. It's, 30 seconds and counting down. And there's this guy with sweat pouring off of his head and he's got wire clippers in his hand and all these wires. Because people, if you clip the wrong wire, we're all dead. If you get this wrong, we're all dead. And he's focusing on, and the music is building and everything is building. And finally, he clips the right wire and saves the day. Got that picture? I mean, the picture I want you to focus on is how intense that moment is. Everything else is tuned out. Everything else is dialed out. And he's so focused on what's before him. Let me tell you why that's important. Because there's a certain attitude that we need to have when we come to church, when we're in the presence of God, that helps us to receive from God. Matthew 8 and verse 18, Jesus said this. He said, "Take heed how you hear." Now, didn't you say what you hear? What you hear is important. You need to hear the word, not just a lot of opinions. You need to hear what the Bible says. But Jesus said, not only is what you hear important, but how you hear what you hear is important. What is your attitude while the message is being preached? What is your attitude? What is your filter system while you're sitting at the feet of Christ? What kind of filter do you use? Skepticism, fear, past, I don't care. How many realize you get out of church what you put into church? So let me just share with you. Let me give you some quick instructions, just as your pastor, as your friend, on how to hear the message or how to sit through church. First of all, you have to tune out, not me. I want to get that in real fast before you said amen and embarrassed you and me. You got to tune out, first of all, the world. There's a lot of distractions. There's a lot of white noise. There's a lot of things that want your attention. And there's a lot of stuff going on outside of your church life that if you let it will come in and rob you of what God wants to do today. And here's the promise I make with you. I make to you this morning. That if you're worried about somebody else stealing your problems, taking your worry, grabbing up your fear, don't. It'll all be there when we finish this morning, okay? You can pick up right where you left off. Nobody wants your troubles. Nobody wants your problems. Nobody's going to steal them. They're all safe and sound. You can pick them up on the way out if you want to. So you got to tune out the world. You got to tune out all of these distractions, and then you have to tune in to God. That's where you got to get intense and say, God, this is a God moment. There's no place I'd rather be. There's no place I need to be. This is where you place me. I need to hear what God is saying to me today. Step one. Step two, don't have a critical spirit. Don't sit through the message with a red pen judging everything. Okay, that went over well. Number three, don't have a know-it-all attitude. And number four, don't have the Holy Spirit complex. Let me tell you what the Holy Spirit complex is. The Holy Spirit complex is when you sit there and say, it's my job to apply this message to everyone around me. I sure hope Frank is listening because he needs this today. I sure hope my husband's getting this because he's been a jerk all week long. Oh, I'm getting the CD for my brother because he needs this. My kids, yeah, this I'm packing this in their lunch this week. And you got this Holy Spirit. Listen, the Holy Spirit is really good about being the Holy Spirit. He can do it. You just focus on what God wants to say to you. See, all the pressure's off. Just you and God now. Acts 17:11 says these men were more noble than those in Thessalonica in that they received the word with all readiness of mind. God says it's a noble thing how you receive the word of God. Beck's translation says they were eager to get the word. See, that's why I say this all the time. This message can change your life. You know why I say that all the time? Because I believe it all the time. Nothing changes your life like the word of God. God will use the foolishness of preaching. God will use a foolish preacher to get a word across to you, to spark something in your mind that the Holy Spirit will take it and ignite it in your life. There's no other thing on this planet that is more important than where you are right now, because God may be giving you a word for your life, for your family, or for your future. So what you think and how you think is important, and here's why. Because if you think wrong, you'll believe wrong. See, your thoughts are like a train. And they're either going to take you towards the life that you want, or they're going to take you away from the life that you want. I shared this illustration, I don't know, maybe a month or so ago, that I'm a little bit directionally challenged sometimes. And I was traveling one time and coming back, and in the airport, I had to get from one terminal to the other terminal, and it was a long way, so you had to take this tram. And I got on the wrong tram, and I'm riding this tram, just having a good time, and life is good. Then I finally realized, I'm going the wrong direction. This is not good. I got to do something. I could stay on that tram and I could continue to worry. I could just be frustrated. I could get mad at God. I could be upset with me. Or I could get off the wrong train onto the right train. So that I could finally get up in the air and get up above some things and change my life and get to where I wanted to go. That's what our thoughts do. That's how we think. Do you know that how you think often determines how you feel? Do you know you can think yourself into depression, or you can think yourself happy? Your thoughts determine your destiny. Proverbs 23:7 says, as a man or woman thinks in his heart, so is he. So let's just get real practical here. We read the verse, 2 Corinthians, bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of the Lord Jesus Christ. Basically means let Jesus be the Lord of your thought life. In the Old Testament, there was a custom when one kingdom conquered another kingdom. What they would do is they would come in and the conquering king would take the king that was conquered and put him in a jail in a cart, and have that cart pulled through the city so that every person in the city, up and down every main thoroughfare, every main street, every person in that city could see their king had been captured and they knew they were defeated. That's the picture that he's painting here, that Paul is painting when he says, bring into captivity every thought to the subjection of the Lord Jesus Christ. That you say, is this a God thought? Is this something that is going to move me forward or not? So let me share this with you in closing. The helmet of salvation teaches me how to repent and replace. So let me show you what I'm talking about. It's a two-step process. That when you have the thought, as an example, I'm a failure. The first thing you need to do when you have that thought, I'm a failure, is you need to repent for thinking that way. Because that is ungodlike and that's not pleasing to God. And after you repent of thinking defeated thinking, then you have to replace that with a thought that says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. When you have the thought that I'm a sinner or I'm not good enough, after you're born again, you need to repent and say, Father, forgive me for wrong thinking, and replace it with a thought that says, the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses me from all unrighteousness. That's the helmet of salvation in action. When you have a thought that says, I can't take anymore or I can't do this anymore, you need to repent of having that attitude of defeat. And then you need to replace it and say, God, you said you would not allow any more on me than what I can handle. When you have the thought that says, I'm afraid, you need to repent. God, forgive me for not trusting you. And you need to replace it with a thought that says, God has not given me the spirit of fear, but of love and power and of a sound mind. How many know what I'm talking about, right? So we repent and then we replace. Now, in this whole sixth chapter that we've opened up, while we were going through this chapter and going through the armor of God in the series Sit, Walk, Stand from Ephesians, God spoke to me very clearly. And he said, there is going to be a spiritual awakening. I've shared this several times. I'll share it several times more till we all get it. God said, there's going to be a spiritual awakening. Now, when I think of spiritual awakening, here's my first thought. The glory of God, the power of God, revival, those feel-good moments in the presence of God, what we've all been, right? I mean, everything is sweet and everything is great and worship is wonderful and everything's good. But God said, that's not what I'm talking about. There is a spiritual awakening unto the realization of spiritual warfare. Because sometimes we've got to pull down some strongholds before we can enjoy the presence of God, before we can enjoy those moments that I'm talking about. Sometimes we've got to work and do some spiritual warfare before we experience that part. And there is an awakening right now because there are a lot of people, and I'm getting ready to do a series. I'm trying to find time to fit it in, and we're moving things around. But I've been doing a lot of study on strongholds. And I really believe that as we work our way through this, and God is just having me parked here, camped out here for a little while in spiritual warfare. And I know I've said this before, Pastor, I don't care about all that stuff. I just want to be a nice, normal Christian, do nice, normal Christian things, hear nice, normal Christian messages. Just want to be a normal Christian. Spiritual warfare has gone on from the beginning of time. In fact, in this study that I'm getting ready to do on strongholds, I'm going to show you that sin is a result for most of the strongholds in our life. I'm also going to point out to you there's a difference between a stronghold and an addiction. See, addiction is the world's terminology. An addiction makes you a victim, but a stronghold is God's terminology, and God tells us strongholds can be broken. We're going to get deep into this, but there's a reason that we're getting deep into this is because I believe that people who have struggled in life, never had victory in certain areas, can experience victory, greater victory. So we're going to go through that. God's going to do some great things in your life. I want you to stand with me this morning, please. And it's very simple where we want to go this morning, but it's very powerful as well. Father, this morning, in these last few minutes that we have together, God, we don't put a time limit on you, but yet I know that you can do in just a few moments things that are life-changing. There can be an encounter to where our lives are never the same. With your heads bowed, I want you to just think for a moment. It's that whole tune out, tune in thing. But how many this morning could say that I have thoughts that have become strongholds in my life? Anybody? Let me see your hand this morning. I have thoughts that have become strongholds in my life. And I want to make Jesus the Lord of my thoughts, right? You can put your hands down. How many this morning would say this? I've been defeated in my thinking. Anybody? I mean, I've just given up. I'm just defeated. I'm broken. I'm worn down. I'm worn out. Well, I believe that God this morning can change our thinking. One word from God changes our life. And those of you that raised your hand, that way of thinking has become a stronghold, has become just a major roadblock in your walk with Christ. That when you come to the place and you say, God, take this way of thinking, take this defeat out of my mind and allow me to be focused on who you are. Father, I come against depression. I come against brokenness. I come against that defeat that people have in their minds, that God, they would begin to experience freedom from every stronghold of the mind. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In fact, let me give this to you. If you were here Wednesday night, you got this. God just gave a word. And here's the thing. When we pray, we don't always understand the power of the phrase, in Jesus' name. Because oftentimes we look at that phrase, in Jesus' name, like making our long prayer than hitting the send button on an email. Here's all of these things, all of my life, all of my problems, all the things I want, send in Jesus' name. No, that's not what that is. When I pray in the name of Jesus, all heaven comes to attention. All of hell comes to attention. There's no other name on heaven, on earth, or beneath the earth. There's no other way to come to Christ, to come to God except through Christ. There's no other authority than the name of Jesus. And when I say in the name of Jesus, I'm telling the devil, I know who I am. I know who I belong to. I know what he said. I know he already defeated you in Jesus' name. When I say in Jesus' name, I am making a declaration of my faith. So whatever I've prayed and whatever I've said in Jesus' name, come on, that's power in prayer. That's power in prayer. When you begin this process of repent and replace, and it may be something you do every day, but that's all right. You do it until that thing begins to break off of your life. It's a stronghold that's got to be tore down and broken. But I pray for victory in your life, victory in your thought. And let me wrap this up. We talked about the helmet of salvation. Let me just focus on that word salvation. And you know where I'm going with this. If you don't have a relationship with Christ, if you've never prayed this prayer that says, Jesus, come into my heart, I'm ready to serve you, then I would love to have the opportunity to lead you in that prayer this morning. I'm not going to ask you to come forward. I'm not going to ask you to step out of your seat, but right where you are, heads are bowed and eyes are closed. And if you don't have a relationship with Christ, but you say today, I want a relationship with Christ. Pastor, when you pray, would you pray for me? Because I want to give my life to Christ today. Raise your hand right now and we'll pray together. And right where you are, God will do a miracle. Anyone, anywhere, want to pray for you this morning. Over there, God bless you. Thank you. Anyone else this morning? God bless you. Thank you. Amen. Guys, I love you. I'm so proud of you. Everybody look at me for just a moment. Those of you that raised your hand, the Bible says, if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth, you will be saved. The good news is we're at the halfway mark. You've raised your hand to say that I believe that God is what I need more than anything else in my life. And I'm ready to make that decision. We're going to take the next step, which is the last step. And we're going to say with our words, with our mouth, and invite Jesus into our hearts. And I'm going to lead you in a prayer. Actually, I'm going to lead all of us in this prayer. So everyone in this building say this prayer with me, with them, together. Let's say this. Dear God, today I come to you just the way that I am. God, I am sorry. I repent of the past. I'm sorry that I've run from you. But today I run to you. Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. You died for my sin. You rose from the dead with resurrection power. And today you offer me eternity, salvation with you. Come into my life. By faith, I am forgiven. By faith, I am saved. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Can we give the Lord a hand, right? Amen. Praise God. We're just simply doing what they're doing in heaven. The angels of God rejoice when someone comes to Christ. Now, those of you that prayed that prayer, there's a yellow or gold celebration card on the seat back in front of you. If you take a moment and look that over, fill it out, drop it in the offering when it comes by. Let us know what's going on in your life. Tell us how much you want us involved in your life. Tell us what information you want. And when we get that, we want to send you a book and some information to help you. But you tell us how much you want us to be involved. We're interested in your next steps as well. Amen? Amen. God bless you this morning. Thank you for listening.
Amen. You can be seated. Everybody say, I have the mind of Christ. Woot, woot. Wow, you guys were better in first service. That's great to see. Hey, so how many of you guys noticed something different about me? You are correct. I did get a haircut this week. Thank you. This is the fruit of the daddy-daughter smackdown. Or you could just say, Frank, you're the fruit. I don't know which. But yes, this did happen, and it has been a very big challenge. And so, you know, when something like this happens, it kind of changes your world a little bit. Anybody know what I'm talking about? There's things that you used to be able to do that you can no longer do because you only have one arm that you can use. At home, we have this three-legged cat. His name is Tripod. I swear Tripod was laughing at me this morning. Anyway, so the one thing about this is the worst by far is the itching. Anybody ever had a cast? Do you know what I'm talking about with the itching? I would rather lick sandpaper than go through this itching. But what's the point? Well, the point is that having only one arm makes life very difficult. I can't blow dry my hair this morning. I'm having a hard time even buttoning my pants. I told Tracy it took me 5 extra minutes in the bathroom right before service because it just makes life very difficult. But how many of you guys know when it comes to our giving, sometimes what we say and what we believe really ties the hands of God to bless our life. And so as Pastor talked today about the mind of Christ and having that mind, I challenge you, get your thoughts right when it comes to your giving and what God will do for you in your life. And so we're going to pray right now, but one thing I want to stress when we pray, I encourage you guys, next week is Easter. And how many of you guys know we're welcoming a lot of guests to our house next weekend? And so we have big expectations for next weekend. I don't know what our faith goal for people getting saved would be, but I would like to throw out there that I would like to see every chair filled. I'd like to have an overflow. When Pastor does the altar call next week, wouldn't it be great if we saw 50, 100 hands go up, people needing to hear the truth about the gospel? And so we're going to not only pray over our offering, but we're going to pray over next weekend, believing that not only is God going to show up, but a lot of visitors are too, and they're going to hear a message that's going to change their life. Amen? Amen. Today, God, we just come before you, and we thank you for the opportunity to give to you. God, we give so that ministry is done, so that people's lives are changed, that it's bigger than us, God. We do it in obedience to you, knowing that you can take what we give, and you can change communities, you can change households, you can change the world. And so, God, right now, we just pray over next week. We are believing that every chair is filled. God, I thank you that when people come in with a heart that says, I am ready to be set free. Because, God, you have set us free. We are a people of freedom because we know you. And there is a world out there in bondage that needs to know freedom. And so today, God, we pull them from the north, the south, the east, and the west, from families, from people we know, from people we don't know. God, I thank you next week is going to be an amazing week full of the life-changing power of the gospel. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. So you guys saw the video at the beginning of the church about inviting people to church. In your chair is a little ticket, and I wish I could hold it better, but this is a ticket you can give to your neighbor. If you are uncomfortable just talking to them about coming, slip this in their mailbox, put it on their doorstep somehow, but let them know they are invited to church next weekend. Amen. Okay, so how many of you guys have ever done the bumper bags before that we do here at Cornerstone? You guys remember our bumper bags? We have a bumper bag deal coming up. I don't have the date yet, but if you would like information on bumper bags, it's where we take a paper bag and we fill it with non-perishables for the food pantry. They have information at the Connection Center, which is right outside there. See, I can't even point. This is awkward. Anyway, so it'll be good if you get that. And lastly, Easter Sunday means a bunch of different things here at Cornerstone, but one of the things it means is youth garage sale. Everybody say garage sale. Garage sale. Now, I talked to Pastor Dallas, and his faith goal to raise this year is $20,000. Last year, we did $17,000. So if you would, if you have donations for the youth garage sale, please get them here. He told me that after first service, they brought a ton of stuff. So if you have anything that can be sold to raise money so youth can go to camp, so youth can go to a missions trip, you are more than welcome to bring it up. If it's too big for you to haul up here, call the church office on Monday. We'll get somebody over to your house. Now, what about today? Here's my challenge to you. Go home today, eat lunch, and then figure out something you can bring to the youth garage sale. They will be down there at Catalyst until 5 o'clock today. So here's your opportunity to give, amen? If you would stand up and let's worship with one more song.
Let's sing it together, come on.
You stand safe through the ages. Your love never changes.
Don't forget to grab that card from your seat and invite somebody this week. Services next week are 9:30 and 11 a.m. But we'll see you Wednesday night, 7 p.m. We love you guys. Have a great week.